It was up in your face!
Oh my God!
All right, well, we've got some bonus questions because we were abruptly cut off the air at midnight Eastern time in the middle of answering fans' questions who tweeted their questions to Paul Heyman and myself using the hashtag ECW Exposed because, of course, you cut off television at the most compelling part of the program to show I don't know what rerun. So we've got more questions from our fans. Are you ready to answer more questions?
Wow.
Yeah.
Are you that ramped up?
What is the first
Where
question?
Where have you been all the... You know, if you had done this on Monday Night Raw, they would never have replaced you with Michael
this
Cole.
This is exactly why I got thrown off Monday Night
they
Raw.
They didn't replace you with Michael Cole. They replaced you with Coach. Of all people, Coach.
Actually, Jim Ross came back to Raw. I was replaced on
ECW.
Well,
what does that tell you? They hate him. Hate him.
I, as far as I'm concerned, we're keeping all this. You can edit around it. Where's the question?
They wanted ECW, right?
They got it.
Oh, they got it, all right. We're going to get
it. I was replaced on the oh, never mind. Okay.
Fly low and slow.
Do you miss running ECW?
Not tonight, I don't.
Is that it?
I don't know.
Do you miss running ECW?
No, I don't miss anything in my life. I never look back. This is the most I've looked back in years. I don't look back. I really don't.
You enjoy being the advocate now for the reigning, defending WWE World Heavyweight Champion, Brock Lesnar. I'm not making fun of you. I've just been dying to do that.
When I went on the road as Paulie Dangerously, people would say, "Do you miss Studio 54?" No, I had a great time at Studio 54, but I moved on from Studio 54. When I left WCW and I started all the behind the scenes stuff in ECW, "Oh, do you miss being Paulie Dangerously?" No, I had fun as Paulie Dangerously, but I don't miss it because now I'm doing this. I lived 7.5 years of my life, day in, day out, 24/7, 365, ECW. And I loved every single solitary minute of it, even the worst moments of it. It was my dream, it was my baby, it was my life. And now it's not my life. Now I've moved on to do something else. And I never spend my time looking back. I spend my time looking forward. If I don't want to be one of these, you know, stereotypical boxers that, you know, sit in a room and they look at the old 8mm projection of themselves, you know, in black and white. "Ah, the right cross by Dempsey," you know. And, "Oh, that's what I was when I was relevant." I want to be relevant, and I don't want to be irrelevant, and I don't want to just say that my best days are behind me, and that I live for the glory of the past. So I live for the glory of the future, and I keep on looking forward into the future, and I don't really live vicariously through my own past.
That was an excellent answer. You should have just gotten into that instead of making me pull teeth, for the love of God. Next question. Do you still hate Eric Bischoff?
It goes back into looking forward and not back. I don't really think about Eric Bischoff. And if I did think about Eric Bischoff, I can't really say that I hate him anymore because ECW grudges died with ECW. But even if ECW grudges didn't die with ECW, hate's a pretty strong emotion. I don't know if I would invest that type of emotion and venom into someone that I don't really have anything to do with anymore.
That's a great answer. As for me,
I like how you say that. That's a great answer, as if you're surprised. Like, oh well, both of his answers are moronic answers.
No,
and then
I just,
come up with shouldn't all my answers be great?
I'm just saying that, despite the fact that we advertised this as ECW Exposed and everything was going to come out, that I still had reservations as to whether or not you wouldn't hold back. You didn't hold back. You let everything go. I guess that's what I'm trying to say, is that I am thrilled that this is exactly what was advertised, because it's so rare in the world today. You are letting everything fly, and I'll do the
we
same.
We always lived up to our stipulations.
I'll do the same. I like Eric Bischoff. Frankly, he was a fan of my work. He wrote it in his book. I had an open invitation to leave ECW. I never did. Went down with the ship.
That son of a I hate him!
Tommy Dreamer and I went down with the ship. I enjoyed working with Eric Bischoff when he was the general manager of Raw, and we still speak every once in a while. So as long as we're putting it all out there, that was a great question.
Well, I wouldn't have gone that far.
Do we have more?
I like him.
Do we have more?
You don't have to like him. I mean, you can just say you don't hate him anymore.
I respect him and I like him.
Wow.
All right. In your eyes, who did you believe would be the biggest star from ECW?
You mean homegrown talent?
Yes.
I thought Taz would have translated better in WWE. I knew the Dudleys were going to be stars no matter where they went. I mean, they had it all. Rob Van Dam. Joey Styles. Honestly.
My wallet.
I can't put myself in that equation, though I think I've done pretty well after ECW because I never...
You think?
I never envisioned myself back on
You're the greatest manager in the history of our industry. Now Bobby Heenan fans can send me nasty tweets.
I mean, I appreciate what you're saying, but I'm not a manager. I'm an advocate.
Whatever you want to call yourself.
Also, but in all seriousness, I never envisioned myself back on the air. I mean, when I came to work in WWE in 2001, part of my deal was I wouldn't go back on the air. And then, of course, Jerry Lawler walked out, and I got the phone call saying, hey, pal, need you to sit in next to Jim Ross for a couple of weeks on Raw.
And you're a new employee who went personally bankrupt fighting tooth and nail to keep his company afloat, and you're certainly not going to say, no, I'm too burnt out to go back on the air.
You know, also, you got to realize being the co-host of Monday Night Raw was an accomplishment I never had made. So, you know, I was co-host of WCW Saturday Night with Jim Ross, you know, the Superstation.
Yeah.
Saturday Night 6:05.
And watched
that
every
was a
week.
Big thing,
yep.
And, you know, and I was co-host of the pay-per-views. Back then, I was the youngest co-host of pay-per-views in history back then. So I had accomplished everything as a commentator in WCW. And then I was the owner of a company at 28. I had never been the co-host of Raw, and that was a prestigious position. Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler had made it their role for 7 or 8 years. So to be, I can't tell you I wasn't tempted anyway, because I was.
That's fantastic. All right, do we have more fan questions? Foreign talent like Masato Tanaka and Tajiri were key in ECW. Who else would you have brought in full-time?
Misawa and Kobashi. I wanted Misawa versus Kobashi on ECW pay-per-view.
Wow.
Almost had it for Heat Wave 1998. And we ended up with Rob Van Dam and Seb. Not that I'm complaining about this. Rob Van Dam and Sabu against Hayabusa and...
Shinzaki, who was Hakushi.
Hakushi.
Here in WWE.
Right.
That was an outstanding match.
And Hayabusa.
Yeah, I think what fans may not know, it's so easy to go online now. You go to YouTube, you go to Daily Motion, you can go to almost any site, and you can find footage of Japanese wrestling. Well, way back in the 90s, you actually had to mail VCR tapes back and forth from the United States to Japan or buy them, or to get around the law, you would do tape exchanges. So for American wrestling fans to see good Japanese wrestlers was very rare, and I think it was a big coup that you were able to get so many Japanese wrestlers in ECW, and I had a blast calling their matches. They don't mess around. I'm not sure that they knew they were sports entertainers.
No, I think actually one of the greatest feuds in ECW, and I would dare say that it would rival Rey Mysterio versus Psychosis and Rey Mysterio versus Juventud Guerrera, was Tajiri versus Super Crazy.
Oh, yeah.
And I would even say that Tajiri versus Super Crazy was outdone by Tajiri versus Super Crazy versus Little Guido.
Yeah. Absolutely. Those three-way matches.
The greatest three-way matches we ever had.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Guido was underrated. He doesn't get as much credit as he should.
What a tremendous workhorse.
Yeah.
And what a pleasure to deal with. What a great company man. What a great ECW company man. And yes, dramatically underrated.
All right. More fan questions. If you could change one thing from ECW, what would it be?
It goes back to an ad sales team. We had a general manager, a de facto CEO named Steve Carroll, and he was in charge of a lot of our business, as you know. And there was a lot of things that Steve Carroll was put in charge of, and he excelled in. We would never have had a video game license without Steve Carroll.
I still have one of those games. I just bought it at a used video game shop, the Acclaim Hardcore Revolution, ECW. Hardcore Revolution, I think
there
it was.
Hardcore Revolution and Anarchy Rules.
Okay.
There were two video games.
The first one I got for $4.99.
We would never have had a video game. We never would have had the deal with the original San Francisco toy makers for our action figures. All of these contracts were negotiated by Steve Carroll, and then we brought in the lawyers. One thing that Steve Carroll did not excel at was ad sales. And in hindsight, if I could change anything about ECW, was again, looking back in hindsight's 2020, I would have put together an ad sales team, or I would have directed Steve to channel some of his energies instead of negotiating a magazine deal or going after this. I think we started going after so many different licenses at a time where we should have concentrated on ad sales, and that we could have desperately used that revenue at that time.
Let me ask you a question. Because we were so over the top at that time, I mean, this is when the Attitude Era started, and I think Extreme Championship Wrestling went to places that even WWE said, we're not going that far. Would we have had a hard time getting major national advertisers?
Yes, but it depends on where you direct your attention. Tommy Boy Records never had a problem sponsoring ECW music. BMG Music never had a problem advertising on ECW. We had a Pinnacle, which was the bodybuilding supplement brand,
yep,
that had no problem. At the end, we had Geffen A&M and Interscope Music. Universal Music, mm-hmm, was advertising on ECW because we had developed a relationship with Jimmy Iovine, mm-hmm, and who actually bought a piece of the company at the very end, which gave us a couple more weeks to negotiate deals. You know, that didn't happen, but still, it all depends on who you would take these deals to. Traditional brands would not have advertised on ECW. But then again, where the business was headed in 2000 and then 2001, the style was going to change. I mean, the blood and guts, the barbed wire had run its course.
So where was it going? If we had continued past 2001 and the barbed wire and the blood and guts had run its course, where were you going to take ECW?
Probably a more progressive style, more based a little bit, kind of a hybrid between MMA and what professional wrestling had become, which would have been identified by the crop that ended up really starting the Ring of Honor promotion. The CM Punks, the Samoa Joes, the Bryan Danielsons, Daniel Bryan, Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins. Most of the crop of the 2002-2003 independents, mm-hmm, would have gravitated towards ECW.
Absolutely.
And certainly, you know, I this is something that Punk and I have spoken about for years. You know, would he have come to ECW? Would I have reached out for him? And he was on our radar.
I remember.
We already knew about him. We knew about Low Ki.
Yep.
I didn't actually, Low Ki was showing up at our events just wanting to wrestle. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't give him a job because it looked like we were going down. I didn't want to start something that, mm-hmm, would never, you know. So that would have been the style. I mean, obviously, the hardcore style had run its course. So with that new style coming in, could we have reached out and branded ourselves with more advertisers?
I think we could have, absolutely. These are great questions. What's our next question? What is your favorite ECW episode?
I'll let you answer that first because I have a very specific answer for that.
I'm going to have to say my favorite ECW episode was the Malenko-Guerrero Classic, the 2 out of 3 falls match, the send-off for Dean and Eddie that we saw on the first part of ECW Exposed, because whatever episode it was on, it was the single greatest match I've ever called. And I understand WrestleMania is in front of 80,000 people and it's seen in 150 countries on pay-per-view. I don't care there's only 1,000 people in that converted bingo hall. It was just magic, and personally, I got lost in the moment when I saw how good and fluid and what a great story Eddie and Dean were telling with their unbelievable athletic skills, and I think a lot of our fans got lost in it as well. So whatever episode that match is on is my favorite episode.
I respect that answer. My answer would be the one-hour broadcast from WrestlePalooza in 1997. That started with the final battle of Tommy Dreamer versus Raven, segued into the return of Sabu, segued into the return of Rob Van Dam, segued into the debut in ECW of Jerry Lawler, which then led to the rematch of Taz versus Sabu, which then led to Taz choking out Shane Douglas in 3 minutes to become the ECW World Television Champion. It was the finest 1 hour of ECW. It was the most indicative of the storyline style that I like to implement. It was Tommy Dreamer and Raven at their best, Beulah at her best, Rob Van Dam at his best, Sabu at his best, Jerry Lawler just phenomenal as the anti-ECW villain coming into our bingo hall. Taz and Sabu, and then Shane Douglas at his best, Francine at her best. And as far as your call, I thought it was your best one-hour call. So in terms of show me one episode of ECW so I understand what the promotion was about, that's the episode I would show somebody.
And you know what we just demonstrated is that you, as the master storyteller, chose the episode with the most best storylines, and me, as the sports play-by-play announcer who called wrestling as if it were a sport, I chose the show where I got to call a match that I felt was pure sport.
Well, the question is, what's your personal favorite? So
yeah.
Obviously you play to the things that mean most to you and that you are most proud of.
All right, and I'm being told in my earpiece here that we have one more question that would be a great way to wrap up ECW Exposed Part 2. That's what I'm calling this. Anyway. How does it feel having such a lasting legacy even after ECW folded 13 years ago?
It's very gratifying, but I don't want it to define me. I'm very hesitant to go through life being ECW pioneer, whatever the adjective that will be put in front of me for ECW. I don't want to be labeled like that. And I'm very proud of it, and I'm very appreciative of it. And I can honestly tell you, it was 7.5 years of my life. I would never trade for any other 7.5 years of my life. But I said it at the end of my DVD, and nobody understood where it came from. You know this. You're a father. My children are my legacy.
Absolutely.
You know, and long after I'm gone, I don't know if it really is going to matter. Or, oh yeah, we're strangers who never really knew me. Say, do you remember ECW? That Paul Heyman, what he put together. What's going to matter is what my children tell their children about me, and that's my legacy. And I know that that's very deep for such, a question like that, where I'm supposed to tell you how much it means to me, and it does mean. It means so much to me that people remember ECW so fondly. But at the end of the day, it can't be the thing that defines me as a man.
Now I'm going to tell you something, because originally I was thinking about the answer before you talked about us being fathers, and I felt my announcing career should have ended after ECW One Night Stand 2005. I'd been out of our industry for 4 years. It was supposed to be just one night. Even though it was a WWE-produced pay-per-view, it was exactly like the original ECW. My career should have ended then. For business reasons, I came to work for WWE as an announcer. 2.5 years in, I started working with WWE Digital Media, and I've never been happier. Love my job. I wish somehow I could have transitioned from ECW One Night Stand 2005 as an announcer and gone right into digital media. But you touched on being a parent, and I want you to hear this story. My son just is the kind of kid who's not interested in sports or what we do, but he loves playing with his action figures and creating stories and superheroes, so I got an action figure. You know, I never got an ECW action figure, I got a WWE action figure. So I said, Joseph, would you like to play with a daddy action figure? And he looked up at me and he goes, no, can't I just play with you? And isn't that the greatest feeling in the world?
Yes.
Because that's what it's all about. And I think that's a great way for us to end ECW Exposed Part 2. On a warm and fuzzy feeling, which makes about as much sense as everything else that went on in this studio tonight. So thank you, Paul, for answering all the questions honestly.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the opportunities you gave me in this industry.
Pleasure's all mine.
I got to thank the WWE television crew, because this show was only an idea a week ago, and it was put together by some
just
very...
Just going to kiss everybody's tuchus?
Honestly, I've never seen people work this hard, this fast, and put this kind of show together.
I did it every week for 7.5 years. Go ahead. Kiss her tuchus. Good night, everybody.
Okay, that wraps it up for ECW Exposed Part 2. I have no idea how all of this will be edited and end up on video on demand, but, I could be unemployed by the time it does.
I know you're jonesing to be on the air all the time.
It's over. Oh, God, no.
It's over now.
Okay. No, 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 no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
The door's that way. Goodbye, I'm trying to leave.
Goodbye, nice people.
Goodbye. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Goodbye. The door's over here.